Thank you, and a very good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I know we are all tired. It's been a long, long day, but just bear with me for a while because I have literally flown across the globe to be here. I've crossed the Atlantic just to be with you guys in the ICD, so I think I deserve this chance. And I've learned a lot of things from Mark today, because one thing is time management, to speak very fast and to speak less. Anyway, as Mark just said, that I'll be speaking on democracy and national elections in Bangladesh and in USA. And my main focus will be, what role does the national election systems in Bangladesh and USA play for strengthening the roots of democracy, and what impact does it have on the concerned parties and candidates? What is the impact of electoral system on the political process and the voters' participation and general citizens' interest in the polls in USA? And how much does democracy mean in an LDC country like Bangladesh, only in words, not in practice? Both USA and Bangladesh have democratically elected government. USA constitution is centuries old, while Bangladesh constitution is just about 46 years old. Both constitutions have been revised and amended according to the needs of the people and the times. USA has come a long way, but Bangladesh has still a long way to go. But there is nothing called the perfect constitution. There are a lot of similarities between national elections of both countries, but the dissimilarities are much, much more. Let's go through a brief survey on how national elections are held in both countries. Like the whole world, Bangladesh also observed the 2016 US presidential elections with keen interest, more so because it had been an eye-opener on many issues like popular votes and electoral college, and some other points too. Mr. Donald Trump was an out-and-out successful businessman who was new to the political arena and had never held any public office in his whole life, and had joined his party, the Republican, just about 2.5 years back before the elections. On the other hand, the other candidate, Hillary Clinton, was an internationally high-profile person, ex-First Lady for 8 years, very powerful ex-Secretary of State for the Obama term, and a globally media-hyped 2016 presidential candidate. But still, proving all assumptions and the world media wrong, Donald Trump won the elections with a vast majority due to his getting 289 electoral college votes. Hillary got about 2 million popular votes more than Trump, but yet she lost in the electoral college votes. That is because of the winner takes them all system. And I suppose we are all familiar with the term winner takes them all. I would say a few words on that, that if in a state there are 30 electoral members, so one candidate gets 17 and the other gets 13, the one person who gets 2 votes more gets all the 30 votes. So the winner takes all the votes. Election in the USA, primary and caucus, sometimes very confusing indeed. As most of us know, that the first step is the congregation of the primary and caucus members, which is in simpler terms are the registered voters of each political party. Among 50 states, 20 states have the caucus electing delegate system. These are Washington, Alaska, Colorado, Hawaii, Kansas, Maine, Minnesota, North Dakota, Nevada, Wyoming, Iowa, American Samoa, Guam, Virgin Island, Puerto Rico, Nebraska, Louisiana, Montana, Idaho, and District of Columbia. These states in a congregation choose their delegates. Each presidential candidate, after getting the nomination of their own party, have to face the congregation of registered voters of these 20 states and convince them to get their votes by announcing their future plans to improve the socio-political economy and all other spheres of the masses and the nation. If each of them gets elected as president, then the caucus elects their delegates. The rest of the states have the primary system, which means that the registered voters of each party, Democrat or Republican, meet in a congregation of their own state separately, in which the presidential candidates seek their votes like they do before the caucus, promising their plans for the future. Then the primary members choose a certain number of delegates who finally choose the presidential candidates. Delegates then meet in a convention to finally choose their party's presidential candidate. This process of choosing primary and caucus delegates takes place during January or February of the election year, while the entire nation's central congregation of delegates takes place in June. National election system in Bangladesh. USA has a multi-party presidential form of government, whereas Bangladesh has a multi-party parliamentary form of government. Prime Minister is the head of the government, and president, a titular head, is the head of the state. The winning party's leader, with majority parliament members, automatically becomes the prime minister. Whereas the president is chosen by the majority votes in the parliament, which obviously belongs to the winning party. So the president and prime minister are invariably from the same political party. There are no primary or caucus members, delegates, or national convention to elect the prime minister or the president, nor are they elected by direct votes. They're elected by the parliament members. Parliament constitutes of 345 members. For 300 seats in the parliament, both men and women are eligible to contest. But due to the socio-economic conditions prevailing in Bangladesh, very few women take part in the direct national elections. There are 45 seats reserved, which are called quota seats, reserved for women, which is later distributed to the respective political parties according to the ratio of their seats and votes they win in the national elections. These parties then distribute these seats among their loyal women followers. The whole country is divided into 300 parliamentary constituencies, for which the chosen candidates of individual parties contest with their party symbols. The choice of these parliament election candidates depend solely on the head of the party. Although there are committees for the purpose, but these committees is more or less a rubber stamp because they have to get the green signal from the party's numero uno, or the party's number one, before choosing each candidate. Normally 5 to 10 people vie for each candidature. Finally, one lucky person gets it. And in between, a lot of money changes hands. These parliament members are elected directly by registered voters of each electoral area, who have to be 18 plus in order to become a voter. Educational qualification are never a precondition to become a parliament member, cabinet minister, or prime minister. Difference between USA and Bangladesh. US Congress, which is called parliament in Bangladesh, is bicameral, consisting of upper house called the Senate, which has 100 members, known as senators, 2 members chosen from each of the 50 states, irrespective of their population. Lower house is the House of Representatives, which has 438 members elected on the basis of the population of the 50 states. Upper and lower house both together have 538 members. With this constitutes the Congress, and the members are commonly known as congressmen. Bangladesh parliament is unicameral, called the parliament, which members are directly elected by the people through the registered voters, one member from each constituency, irrespective of the population of each of the 300 constituencies. National Election Commission conducts and supervises the national elections. The 45 female reserved quota seats makes the parliament members 345 in number. But these reserved seats for women are more like a consolation because they do not have a constituency. So each political party, big or small, is allotted a symbol for the national elections by the Election Commission, while the major parties hang on to their symbols eternally. Normally, the symbols are more popular to the voters than the candidates themselves. Sometimes they don't even know the candidates, they only vote for the symbol. The parliament is elected for a tenure of 5 years. Parliament is supposed to be the supreme and sovereign body in matter of national policymaking. In USA, the president is elected by the Electoral College, whereas in Bangladesh, the leader of the parliament is elected by the majority voters of the parliament members, and obviously the leader of the parliament becomes the prime minister. So the political party that gets the majority parliament members has majority in the parliament, and they elect their own president and their prime minister. The political party which is second becomes the opposition in the parliament. Democracy does not mean much in a country like Bangladesh, where poverty and illiteracy is still a big challenge for any government, and corruption is still a big challenge for any government, and it is a big challenge for good governance since its independence in 1971. Only about ₹850, which is about $10, can still buy a vote from a hungry stomach. Electoral College in USA. The chief difference between US and Bangladesh national elections is the electoral system. US president is elected by the majority voters of the Electoral College, who become electorates through quite a few layers and stages of election from grassroots to the top. Total number of members of the Senate and the House of Representatives, and that is the Congress, is the same as the members of the Electoral College. That means the House, Senate and the House of Representatives, together they have 538 members, and the Electoral College also have 538 members. The 100 senators, 435 in the House of Representatives, and the District of Columbia, which has three, in total 538 constitutes the whole Congress. Cabinet ministers in Bangladesh. The US president chooses his cabinet from the Congress, but he can also choose a minister from outside the Senate or House of Representatives. But for such a person, it is mandatory to get the approval of the majority members of the Senate. Otherwise, he cannot remain in the cabinet. The cabinet members are called secretary, that is, Secretary of State is the foreign minister, Secretary of Defense is the defense minister. But in Bangladesh, the cabinet ministers are called ministers in the cabinet. The prime minister alone chooses his or her entire cabinet. Just that 90% have to be elected parliament members, 10% can be technocrat ministers. In special cases, there can be a few more technocrat ministers, but the technocrat ministers have to be elected as parliament members within 6 months after taking oath. Otherwise, he has to resign after 6 months. In Bangladesh, the head of the contesting political parties, especially the large ones, are very visible and influential during the national elections. Whereas in USA, the heads of the two major political parties do not contest, nor are they very visible, and they do not become presidents. Leader of the political parties in Bangladesh. Although in each political party's manifesto, it is clearly stated that the party would be run absolutely democratically, but it is actually run by one person, that is the head of the party. At present, the two major parties are led by persons who got the position by inheritance, one from the person's late father and the other from the person's late husband. This person's desire is irrevocable law within the party. This each party has so-called their supreme lawmaking body, that is the parliamentary committee or standing committee or many other committees like that, who are supposed to make policies both for their party as well as for the country. Choose candidates for different tiers of election, but in reality, they are just rubber stamps. They are just rubber stamp bodies to be used by the head of the party as he or she desires. Lack of democracy within the political parties result in lack of democracy in the country. And of course, the head of the party that gets the majority seats in the national elections naturally becomes the absolute power in the country. I want to take names here because, firstly, this is not a platform for calling names or abusing names. I'm just talking about the system. And besides being an educationist, I have been very close to politics because of my late husband, who was an out-and-out politician till he died in 2007. He had been a politician all his life. He has been in the cabinet minister in different governments, different parties. So I have had the chance to be a witness politics from 1972, that is when I got married, till the present. And also have been sometimes very, very victimized because of my husband's politics. So what happens is that apparently when you read a political party's manifesto, it is just ideal. It's just ideal. Everything is there. All rules, all laws, all things, everything is there, but it is there only to be preserved in a very very well-kept manual. But otherwise, the party is ruled by one person. You need a lot of oil, lot of butter to be in a good position in the party in a country like Bangladesh. The more oil you give in, the more oiling and buttering you do, the higher up you climb the ladder. And believe you me, all political parties are the same. Because they have one kind of vocabulary when they are in power, and they have a totally opposite vocabulary when they are out of power or in the opposition. So, and War of Independence was fought in 1971. So each of the political party, when they go to power, they speak as if they were the only one who fought and who brought about the independence. Each of them, they speak that way. So what happens is the future generation or the upcoming generation, they never know the real history, what really happened. And they speak in such a way that even the children's books, the school books, the names, the history of the country is changed with every government. So the whole poor kids are totally, absolutely confused about what are they reading. How come for 2 years back I read this, and now after 2 years I'm reading something else? Even the names, the incidents, everything changes. So, and I wouldn't side with one party or the other because all of them are the same. Especially since 1991, there has been national elections, and the parties have come to power through the so-called free and fair national elections. But then there is a lot to read between the lines. The lines that's written in the party's manifesto says very little. But the blanks between the lines speak louder than words. So what happens is whichever party sits in the chair does the same thing, and another party comes to chair, nothing changes, only the faces change. The faces who are in power and the faces who are being victimized. That is the only thing that changes, and nothing else changes. And the country goes on like that. And because my head of the party is the absolute power in capital letters, of the people, by the people, for the people, remains only in slogans and political speeches, but is hardly ever practiced. In USA, the head of the political party is not necessarily the head of the state. But in Bangladesh, the head of winning political party is always the head of the state. Here, the party chief and the head of the government has been all mixed up together, and all power is in one person's hand. There is an article called Article 70 in Bangladesh Parliament's constitution. The discussion remains incomplete without mentioning this Article 70, the controversial Article 70. This means that when a person is elected as parliament member from a certain party, his seat will be declared vacant if he resigns from that party, which means his voters' mandate as parliament member becomes null and void, and if he votes against his party in the parliament. So that means if a parliament member is elected from a certain political party, his political party may be doing anything, but he will not be able to speak against it. He does not have the right to raise his voice. But he will not be forbidden to take part in future polls. The civil society and the conscientious members of the intelligentsia feel that Article 70 defies democracy. And views ensured to him by the constitution of the country. But the two major political parties think that it is necessary for the stability of the government and to make their stay in power longer. So the Article 70 remains. It is controversial, it is being discussed everywhere, but it remains there in the constitution. There are many such loopholes in democracy practiced in Bangladesh. Very slowly, educated people are becoming aware of these loopholes. But as you know, that very educated people are very less in this country. In our country, a literate person means to be able to sign his own name, just to know the alphabets and to be able to sign his name. And that is when there is a percentage of literacy in Bangladesh. That means people who can just sign their name and barely know the alphabets in Bengali, which is the language of there, not in English. In Bengali, they are able to recognize the alphabets and is barely able to sign their name or write their names are supposed to be literate. So when the rate of literacy is counted, all these people are counted. But even then, it is not much. So as you can understand, there are not many people who are really aware of the loopholes of democracy. They are not really aware of their rights, their privileges, and their denial of rights. And it will take a long time for people to really understand that what is their privilege, what is their right, and what is being denied to them. The fundamental rights that is being denied to them, it will take a long time to make them realize or for them to be aware of it. Just as very recently, American people are rethinking about the electoral college system, as according to them, it does not voice the public votes, which negates the right to expression, an integral component of democracy. In the very same way, people in Bangladesh are very, very slowly, but they are gradually becoming aware that of what the political parties say and what they really do, there is a gulf of difference. So this is how the country is running. But as we say, as I told you, that the country was liberated and there was a war for 9 months, and it was liberated in 1971, that which is just 46 years away, and we are marching forward. We are going forward, but we would have done it if we had more like stable political system in our country, people who were handling politics a little bit more tolerant, a little bit more honest, and a little bit more truthful. So we would be really, because the general people in our country, they may be very illiterate or may not exposed to a time, rural life or urban life, but they are very, very hardworking. As you can see, the garments factory, garments is like it's taken over the whole world. It's the cheapest labor in Bangladesh, the cheapest labor. When I walk into a Walmart here, when I walk into a Macy's here, when I see a piece of garment and I see that it's written made in Bangladesh, it is one of the second highest garment exporting country in the world. So people are, I mean, you can buy a person's whole day's labor just for $20, whole days. Which I mean is from morning till night, $20, $25 you can buy a person's work hard. And that is, I'm talking about the really expert laborers, not the laymen. So they still, they're working hard and they're satisfied. And they're satisfied, they don't have any complaints. But what is what they are suffering or what they're ignorant about is that they deserve much more. Deserve much more. And I don't know if you read the papers or on the internet, the political people or their children, they have money all around the world, Swiss bank, this, that way. Sometimes I wonder, where does this money come from? Do they sell leaves from the tree, or they sell the water in the ocean, or what happens? Where does this money come from? How can they send money abroad? So there is something wrong somewhere, and that needs to be fixed in a hurry. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Are there one or two questions or comments for Professor Obaed? I think you actually raised your hand first, and then we'll come to you. Okay, please.
My question is really interesting in Bangladesh politics and the social and cultural. And because especially the present government, 2014, I think, the election is very surprising. Before the election, they declare 55 seats MP. Without election, he's elect. Our Bangladeshi present democracy. And also, it's very unfortunately because last three times was the caretaker government in Bangladesh. And election was so free and fair. And even the UN, United Nations, United States, European Union, and British, they're praising last three, four times election. And it was very fantastically done it. But very unfortunately, the 2014, canceled the caretaker. Even the Supreme Court said, we can go for another term. But the present Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina, she's really killed the democracy in Bangladesh because of the very unfortunately, less than 2% people, they participate the election. Less than 2%. And also in British Parliament, three times they bring the motion and they demand the free, fair election in Bangladesh. And European Union, they say they want to cancel the relationship even in Bangladesh, which is the is not democratic government. And also in Bangladesh, which is the American, also they say the especially Foreign Secretary, well, Secretary of State, they say in Bangladesh they need an immediate free and fair election. And they even didn't recognize the present Prime Minister. And also the Taranko from the United Nations, he been in Bangladesh two, three times to bring the free and fair election. But they ignore present Prime Minister, she is ignorant. The United Nations, United States, European Union. And so I want the doctor, she made a real good speech. I congratulate her. And her husband, he was a very wise man. And he was a Secretary General of Bangladesh Nationalist Party. And he was a great man. I salute him. He was a student leader, ex-student leader. He was a freedom fighter. But I want democracy from the why you don't mention the illegal prime minister, she dictate, and our children they deprive, And the, our lot of MPs, ex-former MPs, they are falsely disappear by the government agent. And more than 2,000 people already disappear. More than even 50,000 people, even last 7 years, killed by the illegal regime. So there is no human rights even. Even there is a, in the so-called, the say, the terrorism. But it's a terrorist, is becoming a present government party's leader, son. He's the IS leader. So it's a Awami League, present government. They are both, they are very dangerous. Technically, they are opposition. And in history, you slaughtered Bangladeshi democracy. Because Bangladeshi prime minister, she appoint the opposition leader as well. And there is no opposition in parliament. Because opposition is a minister. It's a very shame.
Sorry, so, there is a, I'm sorry to interrupt, there is an opposition leader. You cannot tell that there is no opposition leaders. In our country, there is an opposition leader.
I think we are getting into a bad debate. Original speech, I said that I would not like to take any names. Did not take any names. Because this is not the platform for such a thing. I think this lady over here, you wanted to say something.
Please, don't ignore my, you should reply.
There is no question.
You are biased. You are biased. You shouldn't be biased.
Because
UN know the history of Bangladesh. United Nations know the history of Bangladesh. And the United Secretary General, he made a 3 times statement, which is the against this government illegal regime. So that is the, we should talk fair. We learned something from the today, ICD, because we came here to learn, because we can't be a leader. So we want to, because I came here to learn, and my son is a criminal lawyer. He made a statement earlier, he gave his presentation. We want to learn something which is the nice from the ICD, and we should speak truth. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your comments, and I think it is important that we have dialogue, so I appreciate that, and I appreciate also the sensitivities of listening for that. If you don't want to respond, there's no problem. It's not necessary, but I think it is good, of course, to hear
the lady over here wants to say.
If you'd like to add, sorry, I'm sorry.
I'll try to follow that.
Okay.
My name is Syra Meddy. I'm a senior at Noble and Burrito School, and aspiring cultural diplomat. And I just wanted to ask, as I'm sure you know, that there was a large influence, as it said, many news sources say that there was a large influence of from Russia in this election. And I was curious, you know, how you think we can sort of identify those foreign influences, and if there's a possible
In a country like Bangladesh, because it's a very small country, about 180 million people, but it is small. It is one of the LDC countries now. But strategically and geographically, it is in a very, very, very good situation geographically. So obviously, the other countries, bigger countries, they have a lot of interest in the country. But only when I'm weak, only then somebody else is going to interfere. If I am strong, then I don't think anybody will get the chance to interfere. First, like just now, as we were listening to the deliberations of almost a paper, say that democracy or human rights, we have to fix our own democracy. Nobody is going to fix it for us. We have to fix our own people. We have to fix our loopholes, our shortcomings ourselves. We cannot look at somebody else and keep on the blame game. And just taking names or abusing names, that is not the way. We have to educate ourselves. We have to educate our people. We have to make them aware. Only then we will find the right path where. Because if a people are not with somebody, today or tomorrow, that somebody is going to fall. So as to answer your question is, like the influence of Russia or any other country or anybody, all there, because our foreign policy always since 1972 has been friendship to all and malice to none, and that still remains. And we are a small country, we cannot afford to be enemies with anybody, big or small country. But the first thing we need to do is fix our own problems ourselves. And when, I'm not talking about a country, when even an institution becomes corrupt, I'm not taking any names, because I've seen the same thing since 1972 to the present. So when an institution, whether it's a school, college, bank, or a country, when it becomes corrupt, that is the space where foreigners start intruding. So if we can fix that, then this interruption from any other place will stop.
Well, thank you very much to Professor Obaed and also for the discussion that followed. And as I said, I appreciate the discussion and the debate. The goal is not that we all agree on things, but in that sense, I appreciate the fact we could have a brief debate there. One request that I would have, however, the United Nations has requested that we don't actually post political messages. So I think the poster in the back, if whoever put that up could take it down, that would be appropriate just to respect the rules of the UN. But I don't want to do anything in terms of freedom of expression. We can say what we want to say. We can have discussions. We can have debate. Now, the poster that was a request of the UN, though, if we could just respect the rule not to post political messages, would be great. But I really appreciated the paper that you had, and we very much look forward to getting to know Bangladesh ourselves. We're discussing possibilities of also bringing ICD to Bangladesh as well, where I'd love to have a similar discussion and a debate. So let's keep that in mind, inshallah, for a possible future collaboration. And let's take the opportunity now, though, to express our sincere gratitude to Professor Dr. Shaheda Obaed.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.